Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. Have you noticed something abnormal in many famous celebrities? So many of them have a strange looking vein on their foreheads, which is very large and even seems to move. It pops up right in the middle of their foreheads. And one of the biggest tricks they use on us today is that we're always given fake scientific explanations for everything. What they do is that they try to use terms, and they use terminology that sounds scientific in order to trick us into thinking that everything has a, an explanation to do with evolution and chance, and they try to explain away anything to do with the occult or demons or jinn or shayateen or sorcery or anything like that. For example, I've read that the reptilian eyes, the reptilian eyes that many people have noticed in many politicians. I've read that there are some articles on the internet that claim that yes, that's a fact, that some people have reptilian eyes, but it's simply a disease. It's simply a condition that some people have. Some people are just, they have some kind of eye disease, and that's why their eyes look reptilian. I've also read that this huge vein, this same huge vein that we're looking at on this video, is also just a medical condition that some people have. But remember that just because they use scientific sounding terms to explain away these things, it doesn't mean that it's real science. Much of the so-called science we are fed today is fake, and the scientists they interview on television are mostly actors. My question is, why would so many celebrities just happen to have the same exact medical conditions? And why does the media ignore normal people and only allow these specific people with the same supposed medical conditions to become celebrities or to be interviewed on television and other Freemason controlled media? We already know that we can't trust what these Freemasons say and publish in the name of science, whether it's evolution or about food or medicine or vaccines, and of course about political issues and wars. We all know that they love to lie to us and they love to deceive us, and we simply cannot trust the news and trust the politicians. I mean, if you don't know that by now, then you must be very young or you're an idiot. If you're old and you still don't know that, I mean, I'm sorry for you. I mean, there's nothing I can say to you. So for most of us, we know that we have no reason to believe what they tell us. So we have no reason to believe that these are just, abnormalities and medical conditions that people have. And, people in the media and television and, celebrities and actors and politicians just happen to have the same medical conditions and abnormalities. So we know that explanation is a lie, it's a deception. But what do Islamic books say about this? Well, here is a narration from Sunan Tirmizi, which is one of the most authentic hadith books. It is narrated from Umar ibn Umair, who said, when the heads of Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad and his companions were brought, they were stacked in the masjid at Ar-Rahba. So I came to them and they were saying, it has come, and behold, there was a snake going between the heads. It entered the nostrils of Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad and it remained there, and it came out again and went until it had disappeared. Then they said, it has come, so it did that two or three times. So it's saying that there was a snake that kept going back in and out of the heads of these people, such as Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad and his companions, who were Umayyad soldiers. Also, it is narrated in the same book, in Sunan Tirmizi, that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, indeed, Satan flows through you as the blood flows. Could this huge vein you see in the forehead of so many celebrities and politicians actually be a devil or shaitan that is possessing them? Think about it. If Satan can enter our body and live in our blood, as the hadith say, then it means that if Satan wants to possess someone and control their brain, he would have to go all the way to their forehead. So the shaitan would have to be situated in their forehead, near their brain. It is also narrated in Sahih Bukhari, the Prophet said, if any of you gets up from sleep and performs the wuzu, he should wash his nose by putting water in it and then blowing it out 3 times, because Satan has stayed in the upper part of his nose all night. Of course, we all obviously have veins on our foreheads. We all have them. All human beings have veins in their heads and in their foreheads, but not the way these people do. I myself actually tried making faces in front of the mirror and in front of the camera to see if I can pop out a big vein in the middle of my forehead like these people have. And as you can see, no matter how much pressure I applied to my face, nothing like this happened. I know some so-called Muslims are preaching that there is no such thing as demonic or satanic possession, especially recently on the internet, but also in the past. And even I've heard that even some of the Mu'tazila were saying this a long time ago. And this, in recent years, we're often hearing this from many of the hadith rejectors. The verse they quote as their proof that there is no such thing as possession is the following verses. أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. And we had no authority over you, nay, but you were transgressing people. So now the word of our Lord has been justified against us, that we shall certainly be punished together. They claim that these two verses prove that there is no such thing as possession according to Islam. However, firstly, here the Quran is quoting from the people of hellfire. It is saying that some of the people who will go to hell will say this to their companions. So these are actually the words of the kuffar who are going to hell. So why do these hadith rejectors assume that these are accurate statements? Allah is simply informing us of what the kuffar will say to each other when they are going to hell. Secondly, people do have authority over each other in this world. This is a fact. For example, someone might imprison and torture someone else and force them to do bad things. So the Quran isn't saying that no one has authority or control over anyone else. It is simply telling us what the kuffar will say to each other. Thirdly, this is referring to people who will go to hell. So if someone is forcefully controlled or forced or possessed, then it's not their fault and they won't go to hell because, you know, it's been done by force. So yes, those people who will go to hell did bad deeds under their own free will. But if a good person is forced, possessed, or brain damaged, for example, and made to do bad things, he won't actually go to hell because it's not his fault. So these verses have nothing to do with innocent people who were forced to do bad things. These verses clearly say that they are about those people who will go to hell. So the people who will go to hell have no one to blame but themselves. Not the people who are going to paradise and who were, you know, forced to do bad things under torture or through possession. So it is referring to, it is actually saying that the people who will go to hell were not forcefully possessed. Now here is the clear proof from the Quran that Satan or Shaitan does have authority or the power to possess some people. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. when you read the Quran or Quran, seek refuge with Allah from the expelled Satan. He has no authority over those who believe and trust in their Lord. His authority is over those who join him and those who are polytheists. It is also narrated in a hadith, "Verily, they understand but little, and Shaitan or Satan speaks through their mouths." So the hadith tells us that Shaitan can actually possess someone and speak through their mouth. And as I said before, this is what I think is happening today with people like Hamza Yusuf. I mentioned this hadith before in connection with Hamza Yusuf. I said that it could be that he's possessed. Anyway, now you understand why the Freemason-run television is so selective about who they make famous, who they interview, who they give money to, and who they put in charge, whether it be in charge of mosques, churches, or in charge in the government. Now you can also understand why pagan Egyptian tombs and statues often have a snake on their foreheads. You see, these polytheists or idol worshippers were possessed by Satan, and they were even proud of it. That's why so many pagan religions worshipped snakes. For example, the mother of Alexander, whom they call Alexander the Great, Iskandar. His mother herself claimed that one of the gods appeared to her in the form of a snake and had sexual intercourse with her. And that's how she gave birth to Alexander. So this actually means that the homosexual dictator Alexander, or Alexander the Great as they call him, was actually a reptilian hybrid or a demonic hybrid. This is also why many botany Sufis who pray to the Prophet and commit shirk, they themselves claim that the Prophet appears to them in the form of a snake. So you see, in reality, they don't worship the Prophet when they say Ya Muhammad and call upon the Prophet in the same way that they call upon Allah. You know, they say Ya Allah and they say Ya Muhammad. So when they commit shirk, they are not really worshipping the Prophet. And the Prophet himself told us to only worship Allah. So obviously, anyone who worships the Prophet is a liar. And the Quran says, whatever they worship besides Allah is in fact Shaitan or Satan. So if you see someone worshipping the Prophet, if you see some Sufis worshipping the Prophet, or Shias worshipping Ali, in reality they are worshipping Shayateen. And the Berelvi Sufis actually admit that the Prophet appears to them in the form of a snake. This is also why the Kabbalist Jews and many Freemasons have written that the snake in the Garden of Eden was actually good. And some of them even call that snake, who according to Christianity was Satan, some of these Kabbalist Jews and Freemasons, they say that that snake in the Garden of Eden was their Messiah. They actually call him their Messiah and their Savior. And Albert Pike actually said that that snake basically liberated and saved humanity. And Freemason lodges often have many statues of snakes inside them, and there are many, many snake symbols in Freemasonry. And here is a screenshot that I got from the Daily Show, and we see the symbolism of the bricks in the background, and bricks are a very important symbol in Freemasonry. And yeah, of course you can find bricks almost anywhere, but these are indoor bricks inside rather than outside. So and you see this in a lot of Freemason productions, which is actually very unusual to have bricks indoors, you see. And we see that this guy has a massive vein on his forehead. This guy from the Daily Show who's interviewing someone, he has the same massive vein. I mean, it's on almost every famous celebrity, and even some of the ones that are not very famous, they have this huge vein. I mean, some of the most famous celebrities have this. So yeah, we see the same thing on Sean Penn, Robin Williams, Chris Rock, the famous comedian, Angelina Jolie, Sean Stone, who is a disinformation agent, you know, a fake conspiracy theorist that I've exposed in the past, Conan O'Brien, and this guy is the guy who played the Green Ranger in the Power Rangers. Remember, I talked about Green Ranger several times before, and this is the actor that played that role, and we see the same thing again on his forehead.
There is an idea of a Patrick Bateman, some kind of abstraction, but there is no real me, only an entity, something illusory. And though I can hide my cold gaze, and you can shake my hand and feel flesh gripping yours, and maybe you can even sense our lifestyles are probably comparable, I simply am not there.
I know my behavior can be erratic sometimes.
Hey, Paul! Ah!
So, what do you do?
I'm into, murders and executions mostly.
I have all the characteristics of a human being, but not a single clear, identifiable emotion. I simply am not there.
What are you?
You've seen what we are. We use your dead as vessels.
You try to scream, but Jared takes the sound before you make it. You start to freeze, and so it looks you right between the eyes. You're paralyzed.
And here we see the same vein on the forehead of President Obama. And he seems to be shaking hands with Muslims, but of course these are not real Muslims. First of all, a real Muslim does not support the American government, especially the Zionist Barack Obama. And secondly, notice that they are giving the Freemason handshake. And thirdly, Muslim women don't even shake hands with men. Muslim women, they do not shake hands with men, especially women who wear hijab. Yet these women are, you know, pretending to wear hijab, and they are shaking hands with Obama, but it's really a Freemason handshake. See, all this stuff is staged by these demonic, possessed, satanic people.
So that's the first thing that you would do.
It's at the top
aliens
of my
won't
list.
Let it happen. You reveal all their secrets. They exercise strict control over us. So that's the first thing that you would do.
It's at the top
aliens
of my
won't
list.
Let it happen. You reveal all their secrets. They exercise strict control over us.
There's no escaping the jaws of the alien
I'm sure most of you know who this guy is. This is William Cooper, who was a conspiracy theorist who exposed the 9/11 attacks before Alex Jones. And reportedly he was shot and killed by police officers after he exposed 9/11. And so he's supposed to be dead now, right? So, you know, as far as we know, we're told that this guy was a conspiracy theorist. He exposed 9/11 and he got shot and killed. And Alex Jones actually interviewed him once, but then afterwards they turned against each other, and shortly after he was killed. And this is David Kushner, who is a comedian. He's an actor on television. And we see the vein on his forehead. Now, what does this have to do with William Cooper? Well, if you look carefully, you see that there is a huge resemblance between them. And of course, David Kushner looks younger. But of course, we know that these people have a lot of, you know, different methods of making the skin look different, like wearing masks and plastic surgery and all kinds of things. And I do actually believe that William Cooper is actually David Kushner. I believe they're the same person. Now you might say, how could William Cooper and David Kushner be the same person if William Cooper was shot and murdered by the police, by the American police officers?
What are you?
You've seen what we are. We use your dead as vessels.
You hit the door swing
and realize
there's no one left to run.
Stand and face the hounds of hell and rot inside a corpse's shell.
So here's a movie where David Kushner and James Brolin are, you know, in the same movie, they're standing next to each other. But what you're actually seeing here is William Cooper standing next to George W. Bush. That's right. They're wearing masks. Especially, I mean, James Brolin is obviously wearing a mask. I mean, his face really, I mean, looks mask-like. He's like Mrs. Doubtfire, basically. He's wearing a mask. He's George Bush, okay? So William Cooper, the conspiracy theorist William Cooper, is actually standing here next to George Bush in reality. Of course, officially, they're supposed to, they give us fake names, like David Kushner and Brolin. But it's actually William Cooper and George Bush. Remember all the way back in 2008, on my video, How the Illuminati Made Obama President, Part 4, I exposed George Bush as an actor. I showed that George Bush was only acting like a stupid Republican, and that he's really a liberal Satanist, and that he's a, you know, a one of these Zionist pro-homosexual, pro-sodomy liberal, you know, abortionist Satanists. And he's an actor, okay? He was acting all throughout the 8 years. He was acting stupid. I already proved that in 2008. I proved that George Bush was acting stupid. He was deliberately messing up his lines and making himself sound completely idiotic. So, yeah, William Cooper is actually with them. He's on their side now.
For no mere mortal can resist the evil of the thriller.
Need for this. There's no escape. The city's ours. We made it.
What are you talking about?
We fashioned this city on stolen memories.
Notice that it's both actors, both the good guy and the bad guy in the movie, have the massive vein on their forehead. So you see, these movies are actually made by them. It's both the hero of the movie and the villains. They're all on the same side. They're both possessed. It's not like it's only the bad guys in the movies. It's all of them. It's good. It's the good guys and the bad guys. It's the heroes and the villains. And we see here, for example, in Mortal Kombat, we see the bad guy with a massive vein on his forehead. And the hero of the Mortal Kombat movies, Kung Lao, also has a vein on his forehead as well. So you see, and also is it the same with the Matrix. Here is Neo, the actor who plays Neo, Keanu Reeves. And here is his enemy. Agent Smith. So, see, it's not like it's the bad guys who have these veins on their foreheads. It's the actors. It's all of them. These movies are made by possessed people. And Walt Disney, who created the Disney cartoons, the Disney animation, he is provably a Freemason. He's known to be a Freemason. It's a fact. And listen to what it says here. It's an inside joke. It has a double meaning. Pay attention.
You started with Mickey Mouse, but that's not true.
No, I started over 40 years ago.
Don't look at
me. Well, I died a little bit.
You see, to the masses, he seems to be saying that he has dyed his hair. But what he's actually saying is that he has died. It has a double meaning. It's a joke. You see, they're joking with each other. So they're saying one thing to the masses, but it's sort of an inside joke. He's saying that he died. Get it? He died a little.
Over 40 years ago.
Don't look at... Well, I died a little bit.
What are you?
You've seen what we are. We use your dead as vessels.
You close your eyes and hope that this is just imagination. Girl, but all the while, you hear a creature creeping up behind. You're out of time.
In fact, if you joined Freemasonry, you have to sleep inside a tomb. And this is a ritual, and the Freemasons say that you symbolically die during this ritual. It's a ritual where you have to play the role of Hiram Abiff, and you die during this ritual, and then you are reborn. And what actually happens in reality is that, of course, they possess you, and they try to convince you that you're dead. And I'm not saying that this is true. I'm not saying that this stuff that they're saying in these movies and stuff are true. I don't believe that they're actually dead. I believe they are possessed. You see, they want the possessed people to think that they are dead. That's why they make these movies, and they keep saying that you're dead. But they're not actually dead. They're trying to scare the people who are possessed and make them think that they are dead, and there's no way for them to return and control their bodies and to gain full control over their physical body. But the truth is that they are possessed, not dead. Remember that they want us to choose between fear and love. As I've shown before, they keep saying you have to choose between fear and love. And that's what this whole Michael Jackson song, Thriller, is all about. It's about fear. They're trying to make you fear the demons. They're trying to actually help the demons possess you. In other words, if you refuse to love the demons, to love the shayateen, to love the devils, and allow them to possess you, if you refuse to love them, they then instead they try to make you fear them and make you be controlled through fear. And that's why they say you can only choose between fear and love. And of course, here we have Jim Carrey, who, as I've shown before, he says we have to choose between fear and love. I've shown the clip before, and we see the same massive vein on his forehead. And we see the same thing in the British magician, Darren Brown. He's a magician. He actually admits that he's a magician. And here is a screenshot from the movie Schindler's List, which is a movie about the Holocaust. You know, it's a propaganda about the Holocaust to make people believe in it. And here is a Freemason Grandmaster on Sean Stone's YouTube channel. He was interviewed, and he's trying to convince people that Freemasonry is not satanic. And he actually even defends Albert Pike, and he claims that people are taking Albert Pike's quotes out of context. Even though, you know, many other Freemasons clearly said that they're Luciferians, such as, what's his name? Manly P. Hall and Eliphas Levi. They actually admitted in their books that they're Luciferians. So it doesn't even matter what Albert Pike said, or if you don't believe Albert Pike's secret letters to Mazzini. You know, the Freemasons keep saying that these are forgeries and so on, but what about Eliphas Levi? What about Manly P. Hall? What about all these symbolism? What about all their, you know, involvement in politics? And they always like to say that they're not involved in politics, which is one of the biggest jokes. They fully control politics, okay? Politics is run by the Freemasons. Even the differences that exist between the politicians, most of the differences are fake, but even the real differences that exist between the politicians are differences between the Taoist Freemasons and the Zionist Freemasons. So one of the biggest jokes that they tell is when they say that they're not involved in politics, even though George Washington, the founder of America, was a Freemason, and they claim that, yeah, that was all just in the past. No. Barack Obama is a Freemason. George Bush is a Freemason. Bill Clinton, Donald Trump, they're all 100% Freemasons. And they're all Zionist Freemasons. So don't believe what they tell you. They're all a bunch of liars. You see the vein on his forehead, on the forehead of this Freemason Grandmaster who is lying here on the Sean Stone channel. And Sean Stone is, of course, the Shia guy who is promoted by the Iranian television. And if you think Iran is any different from the Freemasons, here is President Ahmadinejad, the the guy that was given to us as the, you know, the biggest enemy of America, the biggest alternative to America and Zionism. You see the same thing with this so-called guy who's actually a transvestite. He's not a guy, he's a woman. And he's a she. And we see the same symbolism in Iran. I mean, we look at Khamenei, the leader of Iran, the so-called supreme leader of Iran. We see the same Zionist symbolism. We see the same symbolism on their television, on their TV programs, same things. And we see the same thing on the celebrities, on the Iranian television. They have the big vein on their forehead as well. The Iranian celebrities on the Iranian television that is admittedly controlled by the government of Iran, they have the same thing. And here is a Zionist Kurd who is fighting against ISIS. And, you know, the poor guy says, oh, we just want to live in peace. We don't, you know, we're just trying to defend ourselves. And you see the vein on this guy's forehead. And then you look at this ISIS fighter, this poster from the ISIS itself. They released this poster themselves. And this is one of their fighters. And look at his forehead. Same thing. See, they're all possessed. They're all possessed. All these people, they're all being deceived by Shaitan. All different sides of this deception. They're all being manipulated by Shayateen. They're all controlled or infiltrated by possessed people.
I don't think there's really such a thing as morality. I think it's a human construct designed to facilitate the control of people. Values, ethics, legal standards, all of these things are human-generated, and they're lumped under some vague idea called morality. Suppose there's no actual objective morality. Suppose there's just a natural, worldly, secular, common-sense standard of behavior whose purpose is what's best for getting along and what's best for survival. That would be a good system. Why should a system like that be overlaid with a sense of spooky, mystical, judgmental oversight?
And here is George Carlin. And as I said before, even though a lot of people on the internet think that George Carlin was such a great truth speaker and he, you know, he was exposing the government and he was so, you know, he was exposing things, and a lot of people are becoming atheists because of him, because he, you know, he was an atheist and he made fun of religion. And as I said before, this guy was actually a disinformation agent. Okay, but near the very end of his life, he actually told the truth. And he actually exposed the Illuminati plans 10 years in advance. And right after he really started telling the truth, he disappeared. And we were told that he died. Okay? Right as he started really genuinely telling the truth, he died. But originally, he was a disinformation agent. And he was possessed. And that's why he said all these blasphemous things. And he insulted religion and God and made fun of religion, and he was actually a deceiver at the beginning. You see, he was a satanic deceiver at the beginning, but later he went against his programming. He got unpossessed and he started telling the truth, and all of a sudden he died. And some people ask, if Osama bin Laden was a real person, then how come they interviewed him on television? Well, the same thing happened to Osama bin Laden as happened to George Carlin. Originally, Osama bin Laden was also being used and he was possessed, and inshallah, I will explain in detail how he was being used. Basically, they were trying to use him to discredit the Sunni governments. So, you know, he went to Sudan, and America told Sudan, the Sudanese government, that they have to hand him over, and then he escaped to Afghanistan, and America told the Taliban that they have to hand him over, and the plan basically was to make all these governments appear like sellouts, all the Sunni governments to appear like sellouts, that they were betraying Osama bin Laden. And in the end, Osama was supposed to escape from Afghanistan, from the Taliban, to Iran. And he was supposed to join the Shias. And then they were going to show that Iran is the only country that protects Osama bin Laden. But he ruined their plans at the last moment by refusing to go to Iran. And the Taliban also ruined the plans of America by refusing to hand over Osama bin Laden, by refusing to agree to, you know, arrest him without evidence. And Osama bin Laden, in his final video, in his final real video, last real video of Osama bin Laden, he did takfir on all the countries that have joined the UN. So that means he did takfir on the government of Iran as well. Okay, and that's why after that, Al Jazeera was no longer allowed to show the real videos of Osama bin Laden. And America even bombed Al Jazeera's buildings in Afghanistan. They actually started attacking Al Jazeera in Afghanistan and told them that they're not allowed to, you know, interview or show Osama bin Laden ever again. And Al Jazeera then changed their rhetoric and they started saying that, yeah, bin Laden was behind 9/11, and they started saying the same things as you hear on the Zionist media. But originally, that was the plan that they had for Osama bin Laden. And that's why they were willing to interview him. And you know, some people ask, you know, how come they won't interview you, you know, me? How come they won't interview me, but they interviewed Osama bin Laden, for example? Why did they show him, but they ignored all the other real people? Because originally, Osama was being used. And Osama's mother was actually a Nusayri. His mother was a Nusayri Shia. So Osama actually came from a Shia family. And apparently, he actually got possessed. But in the end, he went against their programming. He went against their sorcery and possession. And that's why they started to censor him. And they only, after 2001, they only showed us the fake videos of Osama bin Laden. And here are some more examples. Here's the Scientologist actor Tom Cruise. Here is Arnold Schwarzenegger. And even internet celebrities have the same thing. And of course, the internet today is very much controlled. And we see the same thing with internet celebrities as we see on TV celebrities, especially in recent years. Julia Roberts, John Krasinski, so many actors, you know. If I'm just showing you like maybe like 5% of them. There's so many, and these are all like really famous actors from the past and the present. I mean, I'm sure they all have, you know, the same medical conditions. That's what they want us to believe, you know, like it's a medical condition. If you see it somewhere, it's just, you know, someone's, you know, got some kind of a problem with their veins. Someone's got some blood circulation problem, which is actually partially true. It is a medical condition, in a sense. But why do all these celebrities have the same blood circulation or medical condition? It's because it's a devil. It's a shaitan that's inside their bodies. You see, so yes, of course, when you have shaitan in your body, then you will have problem with your blood circulation. But they want us to think that it's all a coincidence, and you know, there's nothing sinister going on. There's no connection. They don't want us to connect things to each other. They don't want us to look at the big picture, and look at this. You know, they just try to say that everything's a coincidence.
Just take it easy. Hey, you stumbled onto something here. Maybe we can all benefit from this slight misunderstanding. Now let's go someplace quiet, so we can talk this over.
I am the mask you wear.
It's me they hear.
Your spirit and your voice in one combined. The phantom of the opera is there inside.
All these clips of songs and movies that I'm showing on this video are also disinformation. Yes, they give you some truth, but they lead you in the wrong direction. These clips, for example, were from Andrew Lloyd's Phantom of the Opera. And the Phantom of the Opera is a story that has been made into numerous books, operas, plays, and movies. What is interesting is that in each of them, the story has a different ending. But the story is always about a singer who is possessed by a phantom who gives her the talent to sing and dance. And there is another man who wants to have a normal relationship with her. And he's often portrayed as a handsome, wealthy man who is respected by society. So basically, he's like a very worldly type of person. like many of the people who sell out to the system and conform with society, like all these so-called respectable politicians and businessmen, the Rockefellers, the Rothschilds, the Freemasons, the Zionist bankers, the people who sell out to the government, you know, those type of people. So in some versions of the story, she chooses this guy and turns against the Phantom, who is basically symbolic of Satan, who is possessing her. So they are saying that if you want to get away from Satan and stop being possessed, you have to become a conformist and marry a rich, handsome guy. However, in other versions of the story, she stays with the Phantom and chooses the love of the Phantom over the superficiality of marrying a rich, handsome, respectable guy. And worst of all, in some versions, she stays friends with both of them, which is the most satanic path that the media and news try to lead us towards all the time. The uniting of the yin and yang, communism and capitalism, blue and red, Democrats and Republicans. Basically, it means embracing everything that's evil. The unity of Iran and Israel, which they're planning for the near future. Of course, the right solution is to marry the person you love. But notice the controlled media constantly associate true love and romance with perversion, liberalism, and Satan. You see, I often say on my videos that we must follow our own heart. And some may think, some may object to what I'm saying and think that, well, why do some movies and other programs say the same thing as you? Because, you know, there are many movies and video games and cartoons that also say follow your heart. The answer is that what I'm saying is that love and morality and piety are all connected. True love, real love, marrying your soulmate, marrying your twin flame, marrying the person that's in your heart, is actually connected to being a pious person. You see, because if you're really in love, you don't want to fornicate and commit adultery with the person you love. You want to be with her forever. So you would want to marry her. You understand? I'm not talking about official marriage, like government-approved marriage. I'm talking about religious marriage. I mean, why won't you marry the person that you love? If you don't love someone, then you just want to have sex with them and leave them, okay? So the morality and true love are actually connected. They're not separate. They're not the opposites. The media portrays them as being the opposites. They try to separate morality and piety from true love and romance, even though they're directly connected in reality. And they want to say that you must choose between a perverted satanic love and a fake morality which is superficial and is really greed and conformism disguised as being religious and moral, such as what we see with the American Republican Party and especially the neocons, you know, those type of Christians who support George Bush or Donald Trump. So true love here is being associated with being possessed by Satan. So I want to show you this final clip from Phantom of the Opera where they associate love with being possessed by Satan or the Phantom. And in this clip you hear them actually saying that love is blind, which means that when you're in love you don't care about appearances. You don't care if your wife or husband is good looking or ugly, rich or poor, healthy or diseased. If the woman you love is, for example, burned in an accident or is on a wheelchair, you still love her and still want to marry her. So it means that you don't change your mind based on superficial things. You don't think, hey, I prefer to marry her because she's a better cook than that other girl, or because she has more money, or because she has a better body, or, you know, she doesn't say that, you know, because he's a better basketball player, or because he has a better job. You know, you don't care about these superficial things. No matter what happens to that person that you love, you still want to marry that person. No matter what happens to them, no matter, you know, if they become ugly, or if they have some kind of disease, and they have some, you know, their face, you know, is burned, or is, you know, if some Satanist Sufi pours acid into her face, you still want to marry her. You care about her soul, her character, not her superficiality. However, notice they use this love is blind terminology to say that it's good to love the evil phantom who is possessing her. And the alternative to that is to go after superficial love based on greed and selfishness.
Sing once again with me, how strange you act. My power over you grows stronger yet. You'll give your love to me, for love is blind.
You see, this is actually what they have been doing since ancient times. As I've said before, this division existed since ancient times in Judaism. There's the Orthodox extremist Jews and the liberal Kabbalist Jews who support perversion, sorcery, and polytheism. The extremist Jews consider almost everything to be forbidden, such as art, music, wearing colorful clothes, and basically anything that is lively, fun, and exciting. They are also against marrying who you love, and instead their rabbis choose their wife or husband for them. Yet they allow some really nasty things in the name of religion, such as the rape of children and incest. But the worst thing is that many of these groups are faking and only pretending to oppose each other in order to fool their members and their younger members and their sons and daughters. And they later unite together, and this is why even the Kabbalist books that are supposedly liberal, they also want to control marriage, and they say similar things about controlling marriage as the extremist Jews, even though the Kabbalists pretend to believe in the concept of soulmates. But if you read their books, they actually say that no, soulmate is simply the person that we force you to marry. You know, the person that we, you know, choose for you to marry, that's your soulmate. It's not the person that you love, it's the person that we tell you to marry. It's the person that's easiest for you to marry. It's the person that, like, you conform with. You know, that's your soulmate. It's the person that you marry, not the person that you love. So you see, there is another, even more evil religion hiding behind both these Orthodox Jews and the liberal Kabbalist Jews, and which they want to initiate their members into joining eventually, and they want to make people actually embrace that and think it is the natural solution to compromise with the other Jews and unite under an ideology that combines both sides. This controlled unity is, of course, pre-planned, even though they try to make it seem like it has occurred naturally. And it is completely satanic in every way. And they repeat this process every generation or every couple of years. In other words, this unity is when they agree to be perverted enough to allow things such as homosexuality, but conservative enough to still oppose love marriage. They agree to be liberal enough to embrace satanic Freemasonry, abortion, idol worship, pantheism, and transsexuality. But at the same time, they agree to be conservative enough to hate Muslims and support Zionism and the occupation of Palestinian lands. Basically, this is what Zionist Freemasonry is. And if you're intelligent enough, you know that this same agenda is being implemented on Christians and Muslims in a very similar way. The fake extremists and the liberals, the Shias and the Nasibis, the liberal Sufis and the Saudis, the right-wing Shias and the left-wing Shias, the Catholics and the Freemasons, the Republicans and the Democrats, and numerous other examples that I've given on my past videos. So in Phantom of the Opera, they are telling you a little truth about possession, but they present a fake solution to you. Basically, think about it. It is the rich, wealthy conformists in reality, in the real world, it is these conformist rich people who conform with the government and conform with the secret societies and with society and with the system. It is they who are actually involved in sorcery and devil worship. You see, they want girls to think that they have two choices. You see, this Phantom of the Opera, this is targeting women, it's targeting girls, and they want them to think that these are the only two choices that they have. Do they want fame through demonic possession and perversion, or do they want wealth and respect from superficial people through conformism? However, in the real world, these famous singers, dancers, actors, and other celebrities are both rich and famous at the same time. They are respected by superficial people, and they conform and do what the directors and producers and the secret societies order them to do. The Satanic Illuminati are both rich and famous. They conform with media lies, and they worship devils and practice sorcery. They are possessed, and they are superficial. So what the media does is that they give you two fake choices, both of which lead in the same direction eventually. They are both Zionist Illuminati paths. It's the liberal Satanist path and the conservative Luciferian path. But they are both the same, because Lucifer is just another word for Satan. And of course, this propaganda is in numerous other programs. I'm just giving the example of Phantom of the Opera here, but there are numerous other films, and the most famous of them is obviously the movie Titanic, which is a perfect example of this type of propaganda. And remember that the movie Titanic was the highest funding movie in American history, and it was actually funded by the American government. All these movies that I'm showing, all these clips from movies and songs, even though they contain some truth in them, they also mix it with a lot of lies and disinformation. And here's, for example, the disinformation in Michael Jackson's song. So don't trust any of them, because they all tell you some truth and then mix it with lies. And here's the disinformation or lie. This is how the Michael Jackson song, The Thriller, tries to deceive people, especially women.
So depressed. I don't know what to do.
Hey, go for it, man.
It's easy for you to say. You got the promotion.
Look, it'll come, all right? Just don't worry about it.
The old cynicism is gone. We have faith in our leaders. We're optimistic as to what becomes of it all. It really boils down to our ability to accept. We don't need pessimism. There are no limits.
It figures it would be something like this.
Our nation. Our ideal.
Oh.
A vision.
Excuse me.
You see, I take these glasses off. She looks like a regular person, doesn't she, huh? Put them back on. Formaldehyde face. That's what we got.
That's enough out of you. You get out or I call the cops.
Call the cops? You know what you need? You need a Brazilian plastic surgeon.
I've got one that can see.
And finally, the disinformation in this movie, They Live. I mean, they're showing you a lot of truth in this movie, but the disinformation in it, the deception in it, is that the main character has to wear sunglasses. He has to wear shades in order to see reality. However, in reality, it's these hybrids themselves who wear sunglasses and shades because they want to cover up their eyes. That's why they invented these glasses, to cover up their reptilian eyes. You see, so it's the opposite. So this guy wears glasses and sees the truth, when in reality, these glasses were made to cover up the reptilians. And this movie is very old. Back then, they used to wear the sunglasses. Today, they wear contact lenses. You see, because it doesn't make sense to wear sunglasses indoors. So because they want to wear them indoors, they invented contact lenses, you see? And that's how they're covering up their reptilian eyes today. And so this is the deception in this movie, because it's trying to make it seem like the heroes are the people who are wearing sunglasses to see these monsters, when in reality, the reptilians I'm not saying anyone who wears these glasses is a reptilian. I mean, everyone has worn them at least once in their life. I mean, I used to wear them too. But they actually invented these glasses in order to cover up the reptilians. But this movie is conditioning you to think the opposite. So that you, when you see someone wearing glasses, you don't suspect them of being reptilians, even though that's what they actually do. They wear glasses or contact lenses to cover up their reptilian eyes. And yeah, this movie is about reptilians. It's got nothing to do with demonic possession.